Chinese communist troops march south, singing about rice and beans. Americans interpreted the Chinese Civil War as a conflict that was based on resources, and particularly on food.
By that summer of 1948, Mao Zedong's communists were sweeping across China. In Washington, alarm bells were ringing.
There's a growing sense that the Cold War was spiraling out of Americans' control. Fear especially that what was going to tilt the Cold War in the Soviets' favor was discontented peasants around the world.
This new threat gave American policymakers an urgent priority.
It was a rather simple idea that no one becomes a communist on a full belly, that we can tilt the scales in favor of the free, capitalist, democratic world. If we can just produce enough food.
Borlaug's miracle wheat might not help peasant farmers in Mexico, but it could win hearts and minds in the struggle against Joseph Stalin and Mao Zedong.
The Rockefeller Foundation bosses in New York, working quite collaboratively with the State Department, come to realize that Borlaug is actually doing something that might be valuable for the global Cold War. A universal program to feed a hungry world.
The Rockefeller Foundation began recasting the Mexico program. Not only was Borlaug given a free hand in Sonora, but his agenda began to eclipse the original mission. Over the next few years, a large staff of Mexican and American scientists and administrators was assigned to Borlaug's wheat project, and a bright new facility built. He would soon need all of those resources and more. The problem appeared in the early 1950s, as Borlaug was achieving unprecedented yields.
He was getting plants with so much grain up there that the 5-foot-long stem just couldn't hold it up. Towards the end of the season, winds would blow whole fields over. He had to find some way to strengthen the stems. And the only way he could see to do that was to shrink the plant.
Borlaug began crossing his top lines with what was called a dwarf wheat, descended from varieties developed in Japan a century before. This time, there were no shortcuts, no lucky breaks, just thousands and thousands of crosses and years of frustration. Finally, in 1962, after 7 years and 8,156 crosses, the dwarf wheat program came through.
He has developed what you can think of as the complete wheat. Wheat that would yield like crazy with fertilizer and water. That's shorter, so all the extra growth will go into grain that will grow anywhere and is as resistant to stem rust as you can possibly be.
It was this amazing development, and Norm patented nothing.
Borlaug's new wheat transformed the program's potential.
The Rockefeller Foundation began to see places in the world where the techniques Borlaug developed in Mexico might be practically used. They started out in a particular place and a particular set of political goals, but increasingly they began to see it as a program for the salvation of the world.